Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to welcome you here at Madrid at the ICSE. It's really a beautiful place here at Madrid. And I have the pleasure to represent BioPharm. That means symbiosis. Symbiosis belongs to the BioPharm GmbH. And my talk today is about bioassays for release and characterization for biopharmaceutical products. Since this is the last presentation of today, I would like to welcome you at our booth. It's right beside on my left-hand side, so please, after the session, we can continue discussion and we'll have a cold beer there. So to the agenda points, I will shortly present our company. Then I will introduce to you why bioassays are very important. What are the purpose of bioassays, the challenges, and what is important for development such bioassays. I represent our symbiosis portfolio. I will go to the types of assay, especially some example to potency assays, and then as a special focus, immunogenicity testing, and we'll end up with a conclusion. Symbiosis was founded in 1986. It's privately owned. It's located in Germany, Heidelberg, and we have there two sites with together of more than 2,000 square meters. We offer services under GLP and GMP conditions. We offer analytics for biopharmaceuticals and classical pharmaceutical compounds. We do method development, method validation, and we do potency testing and immunogenicity testing. So, coming to the questions, why bioassays? Why are they important? The answer is because bioassays or other bioactivity assays can reflect the mode of action. And this is very important. When we are talking about biologics, it's a huge complex molecule, and we are talking target cells. And these target cells have certain receptor where active ingredients interact with the receptor, make a signal transduction, and then make the mode of action of the cell. And this is a complete difference appearance if you're talking about in vitro testings. So, and you will get already a lot of information if you test your compound on a cell line. So, important compound for the complete analytical profile accumulation before a product is released for commercial use. And another important aspect provides information that is not always reflected in a binding assay, for example, in an ELISA system or BioCross system. And this structural changes in the product as a result of a purpose of change. So, when we're talking about bioassays, you will see this kind of assays, especially potency assay. They are needed during the whole value change, starting from target discovery, which end up to the clinical trials and post-market launch. At different stages, for example, at lot release and stability testing, bioassays are needed as well for product characterization during product development, for product comparability following in change, for example, in the manufacturing process, which very often can occur, and also for immunogenicity and impurity testing, and for post-clinical trials, immunogenicity is very important, as well as for the support of safety data. And these kinds of bioassay data are also very important for regulatory submission. So this means bioassays are really essential for drug development, manufacturing, and monitoring. Of course, when we deal with a viable system, there are some challenges which have to be addressed. So, for example, the availability of a certain cell line and maintenance of cells is not always easy. Some cell lines can be easily purchased, but these cell lines have to be in the position that the receptors are present and so on to really see a mode of action at the end of the day. Another important aspect is when you deal with cells is to come over with a critical reactions like supplements, especially FCS, which can have an impact on the growth of the cells. This must be under control. And of course, bioassay requires specialized equipment that are time and cost consuming. Another important assay is when you switch into the development and validation process regarding the performance, that intra-assay variability and intermediate precession, as well as robustness and all other parts of the validation will be accurately addressed. So bioassays maybe one of the most challenging analytical technique. And this holds also true if a process has to be transferred to another laboratory. Since our experience, we know how to deal with such challenges. When we are going to set up a cellular assay, there are some important development aspects. For example, for the first question, which kind of assay has to be chosen, which is the QuAD assay? For example, is it a killing assay or is it a proliferation assay? Furthermore, has this set up to be done under controlled environment? Is it under GLP, GMP condition, or is it not necessary? Other important aspects is the availability of a standard. So if you compare, for example, a biosimilar against another molecule which is already present in the market, to have a well-characterized standard. And all other aspects for storage is also an important factor for this. Last not least, all the data after a bioassay have to be accurately characterized. For this purpose, you need a correct data analysis software program, data sheets. That's all necessary for the process. So, coming to our portfolio, so what can we offer regarding bioassays? So we develop, optimize, and validate assays according to ICH and FDA guidelines. The development, we can develop cell banks and which are qualified for bioassays. We establish criteria for critical reagents and define specification for reference materials required for measuring relative potency. We do cell bank storage and stability programs. We offer release testings. And of course, we offer comparability testing, for example, for biobetters and biosimilars. So there are different possibilities and assays available. I would briefly summarize some assay regarding where we test potency. This could be, for example, a proliferation assay. This is important for molecules like interleukins or GCSF. Other important potency assays are differentiation assays, for example, for growth factor, where alkaline phosphatase activity can be measured. Some antibody exert in a cytotoxin killing effect. You can address this with cytotoxicity assays. Other assays reflect the mode of death. So for this purpose, we use caspase assays to address apoptosis. And also for some components, it's necessary to look for the angiogenesis potential. This will be done with Huvec cell system or with spheroid or transmigration assays. Furthermore, we address safety questions. And set up assays for immunogenicity. One example are assays which require virus as well. And in our laboratories, we have the capability to work under genetic law safety level, as well as requirements to deal with viruses and samples from animal sources. So this is one example for a potency proliferation assay as an example for interleukin 2. The test principle is very easy. We use a lymphoma cytotoxic T lymphocyte cell line where simply interleukin 2 is incubated, and then the cell proliferation can be easily measured by absorption by the conversion of a tetrasodium salt. And this the signal will be compared to an internal standard of interleukin 2, and this can be measured, for example, in the Proline method application. Another example for a potency assay is the so-called cytotoxicity or killing assay. In this example, an anti-MIH class 2 monoclonal antibody was used. And the purpose of this antibody is that it binds MIH class 2 molecules on the surface of cancer cell lines. And these, by the binding selective tumor cells will be killed. And this will be done on KMH2 cell line. As a readout is the survival of cells, and this can be simply plotted against the number, the concentration of the antibody will be titrated against the amount of living cells. I'm coming now to the focus on immunogenicity testing. This is very important to follow proteins, monoclonal antibodies during clinical development. So symbiosis following a three-step screening approach. So we look first or develop a screening assay where we can detect if certain anti-drug antibodies are present, generated by the patient against a protein. And then this kind of positive hits had to be identified by a second screen, by a so-called confirmatory assay. And this type of assay, it's an intention to get rid of the false positive signals, as well to judge if an antibody response is really a valid reaction. Yeah, and then if the antibody reaction is confirmed, then we have to look if these kind of antibodies have a neutralizing effect. Of course, this kind of procedure is regulated by certain guidelines, by EMA guidelines. For example, one important guideline is guideline on bioanalytical method validation or guideline on immunogenicity assessment for biotechnology-derived therapeutic proteins. These guidelines are important to judge if a biological product may elicit an immune response, because several proteins have some protein sequences which are not present in the normal body, or some kinds of the biological products have a tendency for aggregation, and therefore it's very important to look for the tendency if neutralizing antibodies will be generated. To set up such kind of assays has some challenges, because during the assay validation you need a certain material to start the validation, and whenever possible it will be the best chance to have already a positive human sera which already has included neutralizing antibody. If this is not the case, antibodies has to be generated in animals by hyperimmunization to get a standard for the assay development. So if you're looking to the guidelines, there are some recommendations regarding the testing parameters. For a screening assay with first screen, we follow to identify and send a test for acceptance criteria for minimum required dilution. It's the first point we are looking for. Then we have to determine in the sensitivity the lower limit of detection or lower limit of quantification. And quantification is also always is very often a hurdle because an internal standard is not available. Next points are the assay cut point, determination, precision, specificity, and interference assay. Then look for linearity, robustness, drug interference, and at the end, to look for the stability of the serum samples at different temperature and different storage times. This includes as well freeze-thaw procedures. And then the confirmatory assay looks again for selectivity, precision, stability, and robustness. And in the end, this is the most important assay of these three assays is the neutralizing assay, where first the minimal required elution of the assay has to be established, then the limit of detection, then we look again for selectivity, precision, and in the end, again for stability. During the screening assay, you have, of course, different choices. Most of the screening will be done by a ELISA format. In our practical view, mostly a direct format ELISA assay for the test of the samples has great advantages because it's highly sensitive, it's robust and reproducible. So whenever possible, we choose direct format ELISA as a screening assay. And then when the confirmatory assay has to be established, for sure, you need a detection module with differs from your first screening to really confirm the antibody activity. Other possibilities are, for example, a competition system or looking to the direct interaction of the ligand and the receptor, which can be done, for example, by surface plasmon resonance. So if then all the criteria are fulfilled, and if it's clear that you have an antibody which might have a neutralizing potential, this will be then tested in a cell-based assay. This is one example where the drug is a virus, and this virus is used during an oncolytic therapy, in cancer therapy, against a brain tumor. And we will receive samples from the study. And the principle of this virus is that the virus attacks the cancer cells and the cells will be lysed. That means when neutralizing antibodies are present against the virus, which is the active drug, then the cancer cells will survive and will be not lysed anymore. And on this basis, we have developed a neutralizing anti-assay where a pre-incubation will be done with the virus and the neutralizing samples. And then, this virus will be neutralized, and this can be visited by a diagram where we look at the dilution of the neutralizing antibody concentrations. This can be then be present as a titer against the absorption, because the absorption can be measured by a dye, where the survived cells can be stained. So I'm coming to the conclusion. So cell-based bioassays represent a major requirement in drug development, manufacturing, monitoring of biopharmaceuticals. Cell-based assays are one of the most important and challenging techniques used for batch release and for products. And during clinical development of biologicals, this requires safety assays for approval. And here, immunogenicity testing is absolutely important. Cell-based assays require highly experienced specialists in the field, because most of the assays dealing with cells and biological compounds is very tricky. So please profit from our long-standing experience and competitive pricing and customer focus oriented approach. I thank you very much for your attention and for your time. And please welcome us at our booth over there, where we will have a few drinks and snacks for you, and there we can go into deeper discussion. Thank you very much again.